Hey church, we are so thrilled that you're joining us for another day of worship and learning together. If this is your first time with us, I just want to say welcome and we are so glad that you're here. And would you consider letting us know that this is your first time by heading to our website at northeastchristian.org and filling out a Connect card? This will get you more information as to what we're all about here at Northeast and help answer any questions you might have. And while you're there, don't forget to check out all of our resources and get the details on small groups, children's ministries, and youth groups. You can also follow us on social media to stay in the loop on all of our upcoming series and events. We'd also love to connect with you as you watch today. Please take advantage of our chat feature or drop us a comment on whatever platform you're watching from. Again, thanks for joining us today. We pray that this is a place where you feel loved, challenged, and connected.
Good morning, Northeast. We're so glad you guys are here. Would you guys stand with us this morning as we worship? The name above the battle, beyond defeated Savior stands with me, the fighter for God,
It's hard to see what you are doing here in the ruins and where this will lead. Oh, but I know down through the years, I look on this moment and see your hand on it. Know you were here, and I'll testify of the battles you won, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough, and I'll testify of the seasons. sing hallelujah to the Rock of Ages. All that's left is highest praises. So sing hallelujah.
My name is Scott, and I have the privilege of speaking to you about communion. And I want to share an event that I had with communion a few weeks ago when we first started meeting back together again. I went up to take communion, and there was no little bread. And I thought, oh, yeah, that makes sense. We're still in a pandemic, and this way nobody's touching all the bread. And then I saw there were two cups, one cup inside the other, and I thought, well, I'm not sure what this is, but it makes sense. I guess two cups protects against the pandemic. I work in healthcare, and so there's always new things come along. And so I took communion, and it was a few weeks before I realized in the second cup was the bread. Now, I did go through some spiritual existential angst about throwing that second cup away outside in the lobby, but it got me to thinking about how sometimes we take part of Christ's sacrifice, part of Christ's call, part of Christ's blessing, but not the other half. And I was reminded that Jesus said, I've come to call you to live a life abundantly in John chapter 10, verse 10. And not abundant stuff, but an abundant in call and meaning and purpose. And so as we come forward, let's think about that and be sure to know there's two cups there for a reason. And when I was thinking about a life of meaning and purpose, it reminded me of, in my early days, of meeting with a chaplain from World War One. And he was living at his son's house, and he couldn't hardly hear. He was blind, and he spent his day in a wheelchair. And towards the end of our conversation, he said, pray for me, I have many things to do. And I said, well, what do you have to do? Looking at him incapacitated as he was. And he says, the scripture says in Acts that your old men will dream dreams. And then he turned his head to me and he says, I have many dreams to dream. There's a man taking from both cups of Christ's life. Let us think about how we might fully participate in what Jesus has for us. Let's come forward and receive the blood and the body of Christ. Thank you.
Extraordinary men and women went before us with unmatched resilience. Enduring hardship, when called upon to defend and liberate, they said yes. They found courage to rise with every sun, loyalty toward their country, discipline for every command. Even in the darkest hours, they said yes. They cherished and fought for freedom, so those coming behind them were assured of it. And when the moment came for them to give it all, their futures never to be written, they said yes. Today, we think upon their sacrifice and find our way to honor them, saying yes to making the most of what they gave us and filling the earth with God's goodness. We thank them for their yes. They will never be forgotten.
Grateful, thankful for those who have answered that call and said yes and given their lives that we can enjoy the freedoms and privileges that we have today as citizens of this great country. Want to welcome you to Northeast Christian Church. This past week has been a busy week in the life of the Thomas household and many of yours as well, I'm sure. It's graduation season. It is wedding season. And we celebrated both this last week. Our son graduated high school. Dana and I also celebrated 21 years of being married. And so it's, thank you. It's that season. Big fan of marriage, by the way. If you've been married a long time, considering it, please move forward on that. So, and if you're married, stay married. So anyway, I'm going to stop there because I am off the reservation and it gets bad quick. Along the lines of marriage, Zach is actually has been at a wedding this weekend, and so grateful for our team to be able to lead in his absence. He's done a great job of working with and developing some very talented leaders here. So, quick change for a dollar moment. We helped a mother purchase some nice clothes for her son to be able to experience a graduation, as well as a concert recently. You know what that might be like to be able to be in those situations and not have the right attire, and so wanted to encourage them in just a very simple, practical way. Happy to be able to do so. Wouldn't have been easy without us coming alongside with that. So we're in a sermon series called Unashamed right now. This is actually week 8, if you've been tracking with or keeping count. Next week, we're going to wrap up this series and conclude the letter of Romans, and then after that, we'll be getting into a new series the following week. But last week, we were in Romans chapter 12, and we're actually going to be in Romans chapter 12 again today. There's some great teaching from Paul as he starts out Romans 12, talking about not conforming to the pattern of this world, but being transformed by the renewing of your mind. Last week, the topic was all about being all in. We asked the question, are you a follower of Jesus Christ or are you a fan of Jesus Christ? And I mentioned, I think that's a good kind of evaluation question to ask each of ourselves and say, where am I at? How am I doing? It's my hope that we are all in for Jesus Christ, that we are followers of Jesus Christ, not simply fans. So that's the beginning of Romans chapter 12. This is the point, Romans 12, where Paul begins to move towards application. The front part, he's kind of front-loaded his letter with doctrine. This is what we believe about Jesus, about salvation. This is how we are saved. And then the second part, starting really with chapter 12, he gets pretty heavy into application in the rest of the book. So Romans chapter 1 through 11, Paul has mentioned all about how God loves us and saved us. Also how God brings people together into one family. That's kind of the first part of the book. Now if you've been here for this series so far, you've heard me mention several times there are two main groups in the church in Rome. There are Gentile Christians who come from this kind of wild and crazy background. They've kind of done whatever they wanted to with whoever they wanted to, whenever they wanted to, kind of wild and crazy lifestyle. And we also have these Jewish Christians who have come from a very morally upstanding background, at least on the surface. Everything looks good. They look They look the part, if you will. And these two groups have converged together in this church in Rome. And it's probably a little bit awkward at first, but God is so capable of bringing people from different backgrounds together, united about his son, Jesus Christ. That's what he does, bringing them into a family. So that's Romans 1 through 11 for the most part. Then Romans chapter 12, verse 1, Paul starts with this word, therefore, and the idea being, all of this being said, everything that I've written about so far, and then he says in Romans chapter 12 through 16, he kind of turns the table, turns the corner, if you will, and he says, okay, this is how we love God. This is how we live together as one family. So again, the first 11 chapters, how God loves us and saved us, how God brings people together into one family, and then the last 5 chapters, this is how we love God now, based on this, and based on this, this is how we live together as one family. This is how we do life together. The bottom line is God has a plan. God has a plan for your life, and his plan is good. But part of that plan, I get it, I understand it, but it's a little bit intimidating at first, maybe even a little bit scary to some people. Part of his plan is that we are representatives for his son Jesus, that we are those who go and are the light to other people. That is his plan, that as we become followers of Jesus Christ, we are the instrument that God works through to show Jesus to other people. Now, that might feel pretty weighty to some of us. Wow, I don't know that I am ready for that responsibility, but it comes with the territory, friends. Jesus says, go and make disciples, and he does that through us. We are to go and make disciples of Jesus Christ. So, how are we supposed to live? How are we supposed to kind of pull this off? How are we supposed to be the light? Well, Romans 12 and following, Paul begins to show us how. Now, there's a fact for you today. Romans chapter 12 has 21 verses. 21 verses. And yet, in those 21 verses, depending on how you count, give or take, there are 43 different commands. 43 commands that Paul is going to give to us. So again, you might count them a little bit differently, but pretty close to that. And yet the main theme of all of Romans chapter 12 is all about love. Love. How do we love each other? How do we love God? How are we going to get along with each other? So again, the first 11 chapters, Romans 1 through 11, all about God's love for us, this vertical love coming down to us, God loves us. And then the last several chapters, the last 5 chapters of Romans is going to be about our love for God. God loves us, you know, vertical love. And yet we are called to love God as well as our neighbors. So there's some horizontal as well as vertical love going on from this point forward. A lot of people just want to love God. Don't really like people. Had enough of people. Don't really care about people. But I'm going to love God. It doesn't work that way. It really doesn't. The way that we love God is by loving our neighbor. The way that we love God, the way that we show our love for him is by loving his children, our neighbors, our friends, our coworkers, the people that we don't like. By loving others, that is how we love God. That's how we honor him. That is the plan, that we would love people and we would show Jesus to them. So we have the love of God in us, but if we're going to get this right and love God well, we've got to figure out how to love other people well also. This is what Jesus asked us to do previously. John chapter 13, verse 35, we'll come back to this verse a little bit later. But Jesus said, by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. He didn't say, if you memorize the book of John, people will know that you are my disciples. Now that's good, but it's not what he said. He didn't say, if you attend church regularly, people will know that you're my disciples. While that's good, it's not what he said. What he said was, everyone will know that you're my disciples if you love one another. As we love our neighbor, as we love others, people will know, the world will know that you are disciples, that we are disciples of Jesus Christ. So how we love each other is either a good advertisement or a bad advertisement for followers of Jesus Christ, for the church, really. How we love each other is a representation. It is advertisement. So how we love shows who we love. How we love other people shows that we do love Jesus or don't love Jesus well. We can say all that we want to, but how we love others, how we show our love for other people, shows how we love Jesus. So we're going to look at the characteristics of love that Paul talks about, that Paul is talking about in Romans chapter 12, the quality of love. What type of quality of love should there be? The motivation for our love, as well as the right attitude about our love. And I believe that if we get these characteristics right about love, then the action of doing so, of loving our neighbor, will be not simple, but easier for us. If we can understand what Paul is talking about here, we can do this well. And if we can get this right as a church family, then I believe it can spread out into our valley, into our nation, and around the world for that matter. And other churches doing this as well. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, the change begins with him. It does. The change that happens in us begins with Jesus Christ doing a work within us. But it works through the church, and I hope it goes out from here, and I hope it begins today. So the title of the message today, love for your church family. So love for your church family. Number one, the right quality is an agape love. And I'll just tell you right now, I might stumble over that word a few times in the message today. After living in Mexico for a good season, you pronounce that word in Spanish, agape. So instead of agape, you catch the tense difference there a little bit, agape in Spanish. And if you want to practice that, you can on your own. But I'll probably mispronounce it at some point today. Agape is a Greek word. It's a Greek word that... We'll explain in just a moment, but let's get into the text first. Romans chapter 12, verses 9 through 13. We're going to read all of this, then we'll come back and land in a few spots. Paul says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope. You catch what I meant about 43 commands in 21 verses? But keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. That's our text for today, for the most part. We'll get into another few verses as well. But in verse 9, Paul begins with, love must be sincere. Love must be sincere. I want to go into depth on the word love, and specifically the original word agape, that is used here. It's going to show us the quality of love that Paul is talking about. Excuse me, the quality of love that we're supposed to love each other with. In English, we have one word for love. I think that's why the English language is so difficult for us to understand at times. Let me give you an example. The word, the English word, mean. I mean, what does the word mean? You could be mean to someone, right? You could look up what a word means. You could also take the average of a series of numbers, and that would be the mean average of those numbers. One word, meaning easily three different things, and you see what I mean by the word mean? So English can be difficult to understand at times, especially if you're learning English later on in life. Well, love is a word that can be difficult to understand at times in the English language. Because I could say I love my wife. And then immediately after, I could say, I also love bacon cheeseburgers. And I could say, I love to go mountain biking. But you know what I really love? I love to go mountain biking, and then afterwards go eat bacon cheeseburgers, and having done both of those with my wife. I really love that. So you can take the word love, and it can mean several different things, several different levels of things, and it leaves some room for error. Well, in the Greek language, there are four different words for love. C.S. Lewis wrote a book back in 1960. You can still get a hold of it online, I'm sure. But it was called The Four Loves. And he talks about the four Greek words for love that I'm going to mention in the first part of this message. And again, this isn't so that you can be a Bible nerd necessarily, because two of these words aren't actually in Scripture, but they were in the Greek language. But it's so that we can better understand the quality of love that Paul is talking about in Romans chapter 12, so that we can get this right. One Greek word for the word love is the word eros. It's a romantic love. It's honestly a selfish, self-serving love. The word is where we get our word erotic from. Actually means to grab hold of or grasp to. And again, this is all about, I want to be satisfied. That's what that word is about in the original Greek language. This word is not used one time in the Greek New Testament. Doesn't appear in Scripture. Another Greek word for love is in the Greek New Testament, is the word philia. Philia means brotherly love. And as you might imagine, it's where the city of Philadelphia gets its name, the city of brotherly love. This is a love between friends, a fondness for someone else who is our not necessarily a member of our family, but a close relationship to us. Another Greek word for love is the word storge. This is the family love. This is from a parent to a child to a parent, family affection. It might seem strange to us, but the word storge just by itself doesn't appear in Scripture. There's a fourth Greek word for love, and that's the absolute highest, the most significant, the most comprehensive. It is the word that Paul uses here called agape love. It is unconditional love of God. That's a pretty simple statement, but this is the relentless, the all-pursuing, the unchanging, the persistent, the all-consuming love of Almighty God. One of these types of loves is not natural. I mean, we get romantic love. That makes sense. We get the family love. That makes sense. We get the friendship love. But agape love is not, it's not natural. It's only possible because of what God has exampled for us. And Paul begins his letter saying, hey, we our love must be sincere. So agape love was, it was used previously to describe God's love for us in no other context, just God's love for us. Romans chapter 5 verse 8 is one example of that. But God demonstrates his own love for us, this is the agape word, in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, we didn't have it all together. But because God loved us so, he sent his son to die for us. Jesus died for us in that situation. So here we are in Romans chapter 12, and Paul begins to use this word in saying, you need to love one another. Church family, you need to love one another with this type of love. Unconditional, unchanging, relentless, agape love. Same word that Jesus has used previously. The verse that we looked at just a moment ago, John 13, verse 35. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. And Paul follows up later and says, we've got to have this type of love as well. John chapter 21, this was used here when Jesus was talking to Peter. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, this is after Peter has betrayed him. Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said, you know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my lambs. Do you love me more than these? Feed my, this is going to go back and forth a couple different times. This is the type of love that Jesus asked of Peter as well. So this agape love, how God is going to change the world, how people are going to know that we're disciples, how they're going to see Jesus in us is based on how we show this type of love for one another. Paul says this is the baseline type of love that we are to have for one another. This is the quality of love. Well, in the text, after this, Paul, he's going to seem to kind of move outside the church. But the context of this part of his letter, he's talking very much to the church family. We might get into that a little bit next week about how to love people outside the church. But he's very clearly saying, when it comes to the church family, you have got to love each other with this type of agape love. Romans chapter 12, verse 9, again. He says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil, cling to what is good. Some translations actually translate this to say, love must be without hypocrisy. Other versions. Love should be without hypocrisy. Now, that might catch us off guard at first, but that word hypocrisy, in that context, in the original language, is where we get our word hypocrite from, yes? And they would say, hey, don't be a hypocrite with your love. The word hypocrite was used in the Roman drama stage scene for actors on stage who would wear a mask. When they were an actor on stage and they would put a mask on for a scene to play a certain part, they were called a hypocrite. That's who they were. And they would change masks between scenes. They would sometimes change masks in the same scene so that you knew they were all of a sudden playing a different part. So that was just, this is a word that they would have very much understood in the Roman church, in the Roman Empire, because they enjoyed their shows. They would have known what Paul was saying here. Love without hypocrisy. Let us love without hypocrisy. If I were to ask you, do you know who Tom Cruise is? You would say, yeah, the actor. He's been in a lot of movies. Yeah, I know who you're talking about. And I would say, if we were to ask that same question back then to those people about the Tom Cruise of their day, hey, do you know who Tom Cruise is? They would have said, yeah, the hypocrite. And it's not meant as a slam. It's just how they understood this word to mean, that it was someone who pretended to be someone else. And Tom Cruise does a very good job, I think, at pretending to be someone else. I've seen most of his movies. I'm looking forward to seeing the next Top Gun movie when it comes out in like 2030 or something, because it's been delayed so many times. But anyway, he's done a good job at pretending to be someone else. So again, not meant as a slam, just that's what the word meant. Pretending to be somebody else. Actors would wear a mask or hold a mask in front of their face So you know that you knew the part that they were playing. Paul says, agape love does not wear a mask. Agape love is not, it is not with hypocrisy. Agape love is sincere. So let's get practical and personal with this. Romans chapter 12, verse 15, just a few verses later, Paul says, rejoice with those who rejoice and mourn with those who mourn. Now, difficult? Yeah. Pretty difficult at times. And when I say let's get practical and personal with this, I think it's honestly easier to mourn with those who mourn than it might be to rejoice with those who rejoice at times. Let's say that you go to work, and you've been working hard, you know, and you've been there for years now. And you've been putting in the time, you've been showing up early and doing what's asked of you, more than what's asked of you. Leaving late, putting in you're a worker of integrity, you know what you're doing, you work hard, you're a good team player, all of that. And then one day, your friend shows up to work, and let's say they're another follower of Christ too, just hypothetically speaking, and they come up to you and say, hey, guess what? I got the promotion. I got the raise. Isn't that great? And you're excited in that moment, right? Put the mask on. Hey, I'm so happy for you. That's great news. That's so exciting. And then they walk away to go tell somebody else, and, you know, all of a sudden, you change masks. It's not fair. You don't deserve that. You see what I'm saying? When I think it's easier to mourn with those who mourn than it is to rejoice with those who rejoice with sincerity, with joy, without hypocrisy. Paul is saying, hey, your love should be sincere. Don't have a mask. Don't wear a mask. Here's another illustration. I know this is very personal. I know that. But let's say that you have been, you've been trying to start a family. And I had dear friends in Mexico that for years, trying to start a family and just were unable to do so. And not once, not twice, but three times, my wife and I brought children into the world. And we had conversations with them where, hey, we're expecting. And they were excited for us, happy for us. But I know because we had follow-up conversations how painful it was for them afterwards to be celebratory about our joy. It's difficult, and this is personal, and this is practical. And Paul is saying love must be sincere. How do we figure this out? How do we figure out how to be loving without hypocrisy and to do this well? It's not fair. It's not right at times. Let me ask you a question. Is loving without masks difficult? Of course it is. Of course it is at times. Again, I think it's easier to mourn with people who are mourning than it is to rejoice with those who are rejoicing when that rejoicing doesn't necessarily involve us in the same way. He says agape love must be sincere. That's the quality of love that we're supposed to have. Number two, what's the right motivation? Well, the right motivation is for God. The right motivation is God, our Heavenly Father, Almighty God. That's the right motivation. Romans chapter 12, verse 11. Paul says, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Keep the zeal up. Keep the spiritual fervor up. The right motivation is about serving the Lord. I don't know what your household has been like through the years, but there have been a few vacuum cleaners bought in my household due to zealous door-to-door vacuum salesmen who came to our house, put dirt on our floor, on our carpet, used our vacuum cleaner. It looked pretty clean. Did it for a while. And then they would bring their vacuum cleaner over, and they would show us what their vacuum cleaner was capable of. And for $499, we owned a brand new vacuum cleaner, right? I mean, there have been things that have happened. I'm probably off on my numbers a little bit there, just to be transparent. I'm exaggerating a bit. But you understand, when there's someone who has a zealous attitude about something, they're capable of selling you something. Tupperware, right? I want that, right? I mean, come on. You know the movie, right? That's okay. If not, that's all right. But I've got a timeshare sampler story I could share with you as well. And we bought a timeshare sampler simply due to the zealous nature of the salesman on the other side of the table. And 3 hours later, with remorse, we went back and began the six-month process of getting that refunded. It's like, what is it? There's a zealous nature. And Paul is saying, listen, Jesus is not a timeshare. He's not a product or anything like that. But if we have the best, if we have the best news available, the source of power in this life to experience a life to the full, Paul is saying, never be lacking in zeal. Keep your spiritual fervor. Be excited about who Jesus is. The motivation is to honor God and to tell other people about his son Jesus. That is supposed to be the motivator for why we love each other, for why we're excited and why we're positive and why we understand this is a full life, an abundant life. 1 John chapter 3, verse 16 through 18. John writes this: this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions, sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, this is what I want to focus in on. Let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. That our love is the type of love that God has shown to us as well. God loves us. That's the motivation for us. What Paul says seems impossible. He says, never be lacking in zeal, right? Verses 11 and 12 again. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. Never be lacking in zeal. Really, never? I mean, that's difficult, especially right now. I think that we have been worn down over the last 15 months or so. Worn down and exhausted and tired. And he says, never be lacking in zeal. The coronavirus, distancing, masks, vaccines, racial tension, senseless killings, an election cycle. There are a lot of emotions that have been in our world, in our country, for the last several months. There are people who are not happy with decisions I've made or not made, or things I've said or not said. I mean, it feels like we're still just being worn down. And Paul says, never be lacking in zeal. Keep your spiritual fervor alive. Keep excited about Jesus and keep loving people. And that's the type, I mean, it sounds impossible. We cannot do it on our own. We can only do it by the power of God's Holy Spirit alive within us. Romans chapter 5, verse 5. Paul says, hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. That is the source of power. That is the source of power, the motivator for our love for other people. So long as we depend on God's Holy Spirit, we will have enough to continue moving forward. The evil one will try to convince us otherwise. And through maybe momentary situations, temporary situations, maybe even seasons, he will try to convince us otherwise. But if we will depend on God's Holy Spirit, there will always be enough to continue to loving other people the way that God calls us to love them. 1 John chapter 4, verse 19. John says, we love because he first loved us. He first loved us. If we get this right and we understand, wow, in my situation, not perfect, not put together, in my situation, he first loved us. That is why we love other people. That's our motivation. That is the agape type of love. Number three, what's the right attitude that we should have? No scoreboard. What's the right attitude we should have when it comes to loving other people? No scoreboard. Simple concept. It's realized elsewhere in Scripture, but we put others first. It's not about keeping score. It's not about saying, well, they haven't really loved me to the level I've loved them, so we're keeping score is what we do. And Paul says, no scoreboard. Put others first. No keeping score. Now, I like competition. I do. And I like to win. I do. But I can lose gracefully when I've been beaten fairly. Now, nobody likes to lose to a cheater, right? But I can lose gracefully to someone who has outplayed, outwitted, outlasted, whatever we're competing in. My wife cannot. She hates to lose. She is a competitor through and through. It doesn't matter the situation. She hates to lose. And I know there are some of you that can join her and you would look down on me for being able, whatever, that's fine. I like competition. I mountain bike pretty regular. I play basketball fairly regular when I'm not on injured reserve list. I enjoy competition, and competing, especially with people who are younger than me. I enjoy that. It's good for me. Competition brings out discipline in us, and it brings out drive in us. I believe competition is a good thing, individually, team sports, whatever. But when we walk off of the field, no scoreboard. When we get off the trail, when we leave the court, no scoreboard. I look forward to the Denver Broncos dominating again. I look forward to the KU Jayhawks winning again. The Cardinals are first in their division in the National League right now, St. Louis Cardinals. You know, hey, I look forward to those types of things. But when the game is over, when the competition is over, there's no scoreboard in how we love one another. It's not about keeping track. Paul says in Romans chapter 12, verse 10, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. No scoreboard. No scoreboard. In this verse, instead of using the word agape, Paul actually uses the original Greek word phileia, which kind of might be confusing. Some translations say be devoted to one another in brotherly love. So it might sound in verse 9 like he says, hey, love must be sincere. And it's this agape love, this high level of love. And then in the very next verse, he says, hey, with this phileia love, maybe like a lower type of love or something. But he says, he follows right up saying, be devoted, honor one another above yourselves. So it's like Paul brings this phileia love to up a couple notches, saying, hey, be devoted to one another. Stop keeping score. No keeping score. It's not that I'm going to honor you if you love me. No, I will honor you, put you first, in spite of, irrelevant of. It doesn't matter the type of love I'm receiving from you. Growing up, I'm guessing if you had friends or siblings, there have been plenty of those I'll scratch your back if you scratch my back type of moments, right? I'll do you a favor if you do me a favor. There was plenty of opportunity growing up to keep score. I'll cover for you if you cover for me. You don't cover me for me, I'm not going to cover for you. And Paul is saying here, listen, enough is enough. When you're part of a church family, enough is enough. We're not going to love each other at the level other people love us. Now, I've seen this happen in churches time and time again. If someone comes to church and they decide, I'm going to give to the level that I'm receiving. I'm going to love at the level that I'm being loved. I'm going to serve at the level that I feel like I'm being served. It's not going to last. It's not going to work. Eventually, you will feel dissatisfied and move on down the road. I have seen people float from one church to another church, and they say this each and every time. We just can't find a church that meets our needs. Church isn't about meeting your needs. Church is about you helping to serve other people. Jesus didn't want it to be about what you can get. He wanted it to be about what you can give and serve and provide for other people. That's our motivation. Honoring God. Verse 11 again. Romans chapter 12, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Our motivation is because we're serving the Lord. I go to work and I work hard and I do right and I'm honest because I'm serving the Lord. I come to church and I serve selflessly because I'm serving the Lord. God loves you. He loves you. He loves you. I mean, Romans chapter 1 through 11, God loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He has saved you. He has saved you. Jesus gave his life for you. And now that you know you're safe, and it's by grace through faith, we know that Christ died for us. Romans chapter 12, verse 12. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Give this type of stuff away to other people. Paul continues this theme in verse 13. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Give it away. Share with God's people. We are a church family. So share with each other who are in need. Be hospitable to each other. We're blessed to be a blessing. We're not saved by good works, but once we're saved for good works. I want to ask a question. Why can we get along in church for the most part? I think the days of fighting over peddly things are mostly over, I think. Why can we get along in church, but the moment we step outside of church and we're into the world and amongst other people, there's so much division and so much anger and so much hate. I think it's as simple as Jesus. When we keep our eyes focused on Jesus, it is so much easier to stay unified. It will keep us unified. I grabbed hold of these few verses a few years ago, and anytime I'm around this topic, I just keep coming back to them. The writer of Hebrews says this, and we covered these verses in our series last year. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2 and 3, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. So we have our eyes fixed on him. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him. So we have our eyes fixed on him, and we're thinking about him, we're staying focused on him, we're considering him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. I have lost count of how many times division, arguments, fighting has crept up, and the number of times have been quickly able to determine we took our eyes off of Jesus. We've taken our eyes off of Jesus, and we're focusing on other things. And we've allowed ourselves to grow weary and lose heart, to get angry and frustrated, to get divisive. Jesus is the one who breaks down walls that separates us. He is the one who heals the brokenhearted, who enables us to forgive people when we don't feel like forgiving. His supernatural love is the type of love that God has asked us to have for one another. He's the one that the world needs right now. He's the one that the world needs to find in us. Jesus. Let's fix our eyes on him. Consider him. That the world would see Jesus in us. That those who don't yet know him would see him in us. That he would bring unity and healing to people. That's agape love. So that's why I'm asking you what I've been asking you through the series Unashamed, to be unashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, to be unashamed of the good news of Jesus Christ, that we would be a light, that we would carry his love outward. Here's the takeaway this week. Because of God, love others for the win. Now, I don't know if that'll stick with you or not. I try to come up with sticky statements, and I worked this one over quite a bit this week, and that's as good as I could come up with. But I hope that it will stick with you this week. Because of God, because of his love for us first, that is the motivating factor. Let's love others for the win. Doesn't matter who you are, what your background is. I know it's who you are, and I know it's what you've been through. But we don't care about your background. We care about where you are today, and we care about the steps you're taking forward towards God. Are you moving towards him? Is your faith in Jesus Christ growing? Are you becoming more like Christ? If you're part of this church family, then you are a brother or sister in Christ. And we need to have the agape love for one another. Now, if you haven't yet made that decision, it's our hope and prayer that you would. And soon. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. It is our hope and prayer that you would become a follower of Jesus Christ, that you would take steps towards him, to follow after him, that you would repent of sin, that you would make the decision to be baptized, that you would commit, you know what, I'm going to live my life for Jesus Christ, following after him. I'm going to love other people. I'm going to follow after Jesus Christ. I'm going to do my best to follow life according to his word. That's our hope and prayer for you if you haven't yet. Let me pray for us. God, we thank you for the day. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together and worship. And Lord, as we leave here, I ask that you would, through your Spirit, convict where that needs to happen, empower us to love others as you have loved us. That our attitude would be an agape type of love, a selfless love, an unchanging, relentless love for other people. That our motivator would be to honor you because you first loved us. Father, help us to do this well. Help us to get this right. No scoreboard. No keeping track. That we would just be a people who loves one another and others would know that we're disciples, we're followers of Christ. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
A couple of announcements. The first, for moms, June 6th, Sunday afternoon at 4 o'clock, you're invited to meet at Instrum's for coffee and ice cream. Sounds good to me. And then if you're new to our church or you've been visiting for a while and keeping a low profile but want to know more about the church, I would invite you to meet with someone out at Connect Central. It's right out here in the lobby. And introduce yourself, and there'll be a gift bag as well. As we go out this week, let us remember, because of God, to love others for the win. Say hi to someone.